glory, and inspiration 24 hours a day. UBM Praise Chicago, a service of the UBM Networks.
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Let's go.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who you with?
Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show. Co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it? It's politics.
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again. But with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
If I were you, I would say, yeah.
Speak, Lord.
Speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Speak to me.
Speak, Lord.
Oh, speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Don't you speak to me.
Sir Walter Jones Show. I am he. It is Thursday. Theology Thursday. Man, we sit around the mic and talk to the brothers, the elders, about the Word of God. The B-I-B-L-E, man. That's the book for me. I'm just excited about today's topic, as we are. I'm always excited about today's topic. Mm-hmm. We are going there today because I just want to answer some questions about what Jesus said. You know, this is a difficult one here today. You know, we've had some difficult topics, but this one right here is a hard one. Just like it was last week, we talked about the healing thing. Well, the one before that. Last week, we talked about men in church. Why they ain't hanging around the church house. And we have come to the decision is that y'all putting up the curtains. Mm-hmm. Take the curtains down. And they might show up. Put some blue up in there. Take that pink down.
Put some man colors in there.
Yeah, and add some electric guitars and some smoke screen. Maybe put a magic show up in there with some bunnies. I don't know, but do something. But don't compromise the Word of God. Don't do that whatsoever, because the Bible says it is the preaching of the cross which saves man's souls. So you can change all the aesthetics of the church all you want to. You know, the brothers got to hear the challenge them with the Word of God. Today we're talking about the greater of works that Christ was talking about in Scripture, and we need to figure out what did he mean by this great works, and does it apply to us? Okay, and some of you will have a problem with today's. We'll have to go to John chapter 14, 12. Let me see if I can go here. The Elder Riley Jones is here. How you doing, Elder Jones?
I'm doing fine and dandy. How you?
I'm fine and dandy. How's your mammy?
She's fine.
And yours? Yeah, well, his mammy is my mammy, too. How about that? boy, you see how I did that? It's all right. Well, I'm a poet, didn't know it. John 14, 12. Let's see. We're going to John 14, 8. This is Christ answering Philip. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Mm. And she said to him, have I been so long time with you?
Long time.
I've been here a long time. It's and yet has not, have thou not known me, Philip? He that have seen me have seen the Father.
That's the problem right there. You know, the a lot of our brethren of other persuasions believe that Jesus is saying he is the Father.
Right.
Because he said, when you see the Father, you see me.
That's right.
But they don't read the rest of the verse.
The rest of the story.
Yes. Page two.
Uh-huh.
So there, right there lies a problem.
Lies a problem.
Yeah.
It's a big problem.
Mm-hmm.
And how, and possibly this is where the whole Jesus only come from.
Yeah.
This is one of them.
Yeah, one of the scriptures.
Yeah.
And it's something, and we are getting ready to get together with ministers and preachers so we can have a Bible session just among us.
Yes.
Because what we're finding out is our younger breed of preachers,
mm-hmm.
they're going forth, but they don't have no substance.
They
don't have no history. They don't have information.
Mm-hmm.
And they just going for the squall and true. All of that.
True.
But there's more to it than just hollering. You've got to have some substance.
So help us out with that.
Mm-hmm.
We got 2 hours. Why not?
Sure.
Where did this come from? Are they trying to just emulate what they've been seeing all their lives and thinking that's the way?
Yeah. They think preaching is just hollering.
Yeah.
Even though preaching is hollering.
Some hollering.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's called heralding.
Heralding.
Oh, yeah. That one, too.
Uh-huh. Hark the herald.
Yeah. Hark the heralding.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's that. But the problem we're having is preachers tend to take stuff out of its context.
Yes.
And so when you take scripture out of context, you just really messed up the whole thing.
True.
So if you're going to preach, first, give us the information in the context that it's in.
True.
Number one.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, give us the understanding of it or the interpretation. What did God mean when he said this? And then number three, then you can give us an application on how this scripture, what does this scripture got to do with me today, Reverend?
That's good.
You know.
I think what the problem is, remember the Apostle Paul was talking about the gifts.
Mm-hmm.
And what happened was they were, what's the word? I want yours.
Covet?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
They were trying to covet the gifts that made them
look
powerful and,
yes.
and good and whatever before mm-hmm. the people.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody wanted to speak in tongues.
True.
So the Apostle Paul had to address this whole tongue thing
mm-hmm.
because it was something, and history repeats itself because that's still going on today.
It's going on right now. It's an abuse of it.
It's abuse of it, and we covered what we think is to get the most attention.
Yeah.
Because remember, back in the day, they don't do this anymore, but if the church was going up, going forth for the Lord, and somebody was speaking tongues,
mm-hmm.
what happened to the whole generation, audience?
They would be quiet.
They would hush.
And even the minister would hush. God is speaking.
He's speaking. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Okay, now, which is in order?
It's in order for a moment of time.
Yes.
Because mm-hmm. he has to make sure that God is speaking.
Right.
So, but there has to be an interpreter, or the person mm-hmm. that's speaking would have to
interpret. That. Yeah. We forget to read all of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, we don't read any of that. Attention. All right, so we're coveting that gift.
Mm-hmm.
What other gift you think that the man usually covered as far as the spiritual gifts of the Spirit? The most?
Speaking in tongues is mm-hmm. one, and prophesying. Mm-hmm.
Prophesying.
Yes.
Big one.
Yes.
Big one.
Yes,
he'll walk up to you. Anybody walk up to you.
Oh,
the Lord has told me. Yeah, let me speak into your life. Okay,
yeah.
And then, you know, and then we get all giddy when we hear that. It
yes.
don't matter who it's coming from.
Nope.
We get all giddy.
The minute they say, yay, thus saith the Lord.
Thus said.
Then it becomes.
Yes.
So we use the king's language.
Uh-huh, uh-huh, uh-huh.
So now it become authentic.
It's authentic now that we use the king's language.
And, you know, it's so funny because they use general terms.
Yes, they do. Very general.
Oh, you know, the Lord says you're going through.
You're going through.
Everybody on the face of the
earth
is
going through. Everybody in this room going through.
Yeah, even including the person that's prophesying.
Come on, brother.
Yeah, the person that's prophesying is going through.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we use a lot of general colloquial phrases.
Yes, we do.
To get our points over with, and people just be dying. And then number two. You can read body language.
Yes, you can.
It's very simple to do.
Uh-huh.
Because the minute you mention someone is going through, and their head go back, their eyes closed, you got it.
Yeah.
You know exactly what to say.
Yeah.
I say this to prophets. Don't ask no questions. Just start telling me everything.
Tell them. Yes.
And don't even look for me to say yes or no.
Yep. That's right.
Just come straight out with it. That's what right. the prophets did in the Old Testament.
Sure did.
They didn't ask you, do I know you? Yeah. Do you know me?
Yes. Yeah. Right. Yeah, and you know why they have to keep doing that stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because people in the room, mm-hmm. and they want to prove or properly vet themselves
yes.
before the people.
Mm-hmm.
They'll call out your phone number or
yeah.
your home address and mm-hmm. stuff like that,
mm-hmm.
so that the people could believe in them, so that you can believe.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I got my emotions over here, my emotion over here. About all of that.
Right.
I just stay away
from
it.
Like your emotions are out of balance.
My emotions is like the ox, you know. Yeah. So I stay away from it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if somebody's speaking to me and they're trying to speak a word of wisdom, and I don't ignore it. No.
Right.
But
right.
I don't run into that audience. I'm
right.
the crowd.
Yeah, that runs for a word.
No, I'm not doing it. The new prophet come to town.
No,
I ain't showing up.
I'm not running to him.
I don't have to do that. Yeah. Most of the word of wisdom that I got,
mm-hmm.
most of it came out of this book.
Straight out of the Bible. Because
right
God speaks every day. We're just mm-hmm. not listening
we're
to
not
him.
Listening. Mm-hmm.
And his word is written, but we're just not listening to it.
We're not listening to it, and we don't want to read it.
Don't want to read it. We're the most lazy people I know on the face of this earth.
Oh, yada, yada, yada.
Yes, sir. That, you know, that's the Greek word for knowledge.
That's the Greek word for knowledge. It sure is.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So when you be telling your wife, yada, yada, yada,
yada, yada, yada.
You be telling her, I have a lot of knowledge.
He that have seen me have seen the Father, and how sayest thou then, show us the Father?
Mm-hmm.
That's the question, Philip.
Mm-hmm.
Believest thou not that I am in the Father, that I am
in the Father? And notice he didn't say mm-hmm. I am the Father.
He said, I'm in him.
I'm in the Father.
And the Father is in me.
And the Father is in me.
The words that I speak unto mm-hmm. you, I speak not of myself,
mm-hmm.
but the Father that dwelleth in me,
mm-hmm.
he
mm-hmm.
does the work.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 11. Okay, we in John 14, verse 11. It says, believe me that I am the Father, and the Father in me, or
believe
else.
Believe me what?
Believe me that I am in the Father.
In the Father.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And the Father is not in my contact lenses right now.
Okay.
Or else believe me for
my works.
The very works sake.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Verily, verily. Well, verily, verily. What are you talking about?
Truly.
Yeah. Truly, truly.
Mm-hmm.
I say unto you, he that believeth on me,
mm-hmm.
the works that I do, shall he do also, mm-hmm. and greater works than these shall he do.
Mm-hmm.
Because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name.
In his name.
Now, let's not go no further. Back
mm-hmm.
up.
Mm-hmm.
Back that thing up
mm-hmm.
to number 12.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Did he say that?
I said it.
Mm-hmm.
I own this show. I can say it.
Back up.
Back up. And he says, and greater works than these
mm-hmm.
shall he do. Greater work than what's the these?
The works that he has already done.
Stuff he already did.
Already done.
Because when he went out in the street, he healed them all.
Everybody that was brought to uh-huh. Jesus, he healed them. There was not uh-huh. one person that he did not heal.
And he didn't turn nobody away.
Didn't turn nobody away.
He entertained all questions, too.
Yes, sir.
Even though some of them were stupid questions,
stupid, yes.
he still answered them.
And sometimes he answered a question with a question.
He sure did.
He asked him the baptism of John. Was yep. it of God or of man?
There you go. Because he's a Jew. They always ask questions. On questions.
Right. Exactly. But y'all told me I couldn't do it.
Y'all told we could not ask a question. We couldn't question God.
Yeah, no, no.
What?
They told me I couldn't ask a question with
yeah,
a question.
With a question. Oh, yeah, no.
But mm-mm. then I want to be like Jesus.
I want to be like Jesus.
Yeah, he answered.
Yes.
He asked a question mm-hmm. with a question.
And a lot of times he did that. Mm-hmm. But that, again, that's those people. The Hebrews do a lot of that even today.
Yeah.
You go to a real Hebrew,
mm-hmm.
they're going to ask you a question. But let me ask you a question. No pun intended. Why response of a question upon a question?
It's to cause the person who asked the first question to think.
Yes, sir.
Think.
Think.
Think what? Because sometimes mm-hmm. when he asked the question mm-hmm. based on your question, when you give the answer to his question, you just answered your question.
You just answered it. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, because a lot of times we know the answer.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost there. Okay, mm-hmm. it's almost there sometimes. And so you asking a question will just bring it out.
Right.
Bring out the fullness of it. Who was it? I have counselor friends.
Sorry to hear that.
I know. They have degrees. They're psychologists, what have you. They counsel people, okay? Uh-huh. I learned more about with talking with counselors than I did a lot of preachers.
When you was talking to them, you was next to them or you was on the couch?
I was laying down. Yeah.
Okay.
I was laying prostrate.
Right,
okay?
Right.
But here's what I learned from the counselor. Uh-huh. And I realized I was doing the same thing. Didn't know when I'm counseling people, that's exactly what I would do.
Mm-hmm.
The counselor says, when in school, what we learned was you don't solve their problem.
You don't solve their problem.
No, you don't give them.
You ask them questions.
Yes, you ask them questions, and then you let them come up with their own solution.
That's why what's his name asks, how's that working for you?
Yeah, how's that working for you?
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
But now my stepmother, mother-in-law, whatever you call it, she says preachers think they are counselors.
Right.
But preachers, she says, most preachers are advisors.
Yes, they are.
Because we spend more time giving advice to people rather than allowing them to figure out their own problem based on the information that they've given us.
That's so true.
And we think we're counselors, yet we don't know that that's not what counselors do.
Right.
They ask questions and allow you to really solve it by just allowing you to talk, and they just ask the right question.
They just ask the right question. Man. That's good stuff right there. Now, I went to a counseling. When I was married, I went to married counseling for the first time.
Mm.
I mean, I'm talking about a real counselor.
Yeah.
I don't want to offend nobody, but I ain't talking about no pastor. I don't want to offend nobody, but my problem, I needed someone that I didn't know.
True. Oh, I understand that.
You get
that? I understand that.
And the person who sent me to a counselor was my own pastor.
Right.
All
right?
That's why I'm with him still today, because that took humility.
Counselor or the pastor?
The pastor. Okay. I can't afford a counselor no more. Because I'm not married no more, so why pay all that money? Okay? So I went to a guy. Now, he was a believer. He was saved.
Okay.
So it wasn't some cat. You know, because they went to college, that don't make them the best counselors because they went to college. They still have to know the Lord.
Oh, yes.
Okay,
yes.
For them to give me good
biblical ordinary, every day. He's
absolutely
got to be able to give you on both sides.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay, and so he just sat there and asked me more questions than him giving me advice.
True.
By the time he asked me the last question, I got it.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, my gosh. I got it. I got it. And then I began to give him answers. Okay, based on all the questions he asked. He said, okay, my job is done.
Exactly.
And now the woman sitting next to me says, why are you paying him? And you doing all the talking.
Right.
And he doing all the questions. I said, he just fixed the problem.
That's what he's
that I that's had his for job. 30 years.
That's his job.
That's his job. Okay.
I tell people, it's not my job as a preacher to make you live holy.
Yeah. Woo, Lord have mercy.
It's my job to preach to you about holiness. It's your job.
Yes.
To live it yourself.
Yes.
It's my job to live holy and to preach to you, but it's your job to take the information that I've given you.
Yes.
And it's for you to live. I'm not going to go behind nobody, see who is or who ain't living
who
holy.
Who is or
that
who?
Ain't not my job.
That ain't not.
That's what I
his
mean.
His job.
That ain't all, y'all.
That ain't all. Let's see. Facebook Live is chiming here. I am so leery of these so-called prophets. They are so general. That's what Dietrich says. I've learned how to pronounce her name properly this time. Larry Jones. Now, this is not our Larry Jones. This is people fear what the do not understand, period. What they do not understand, period.
There's more than one Larry Jones?
Yeah, I have two Larry Joneses on my thing.
I don't know
if this is our Larry Jones or not. You are Larry Jones too, Larry Jones. I'm sorry to say that. You know, I didn't mean about it. Sherry A. Shopper.
Hey, Sherry.
Yeah, she's sharp.
Purr.
I agree with Larry Jones. People fear the unknown when they should show reverence to God, fear him out of love. Okay? And then Flora Stitt, my favorite from Florida. Lord, that woman right there says some
who
people.
That?
Flora, you know Bonnie Bronson from Florida?
Yeah.
Bethune Cookman, this is her sister. Dr. Bronson? The president?
Yeah.
This is his daughter.
Oh.
This is Florida, the great,
well,
the magnificent Florida. She says, some people don't understand that they should go to someone they don't know. Come on, I'm hitting the up.
Hit the light button.
It's not
button.
A like, it's a thumb now.
Right, it's a thumb. The problem is, you go to somebody, you know them, they know you. I say this, everybody can't be a preacher, because when it comes time to pray for people, can you rightfully pray for someone and you know some dirt about them?
Right.
Can you effectively stand there and pray for this brother after he didn't have a relationship with your wife?
Yes.
And he's a member of the same church.
Oh, boy.
Can you do that?
Uh-oh.
So everybody can't be a preacher, and everybody can't... You're covering it, Doc.
No, I see it from on my end. It may look covered, but I see it.
I see the whole thing. See, I see what you don't see. I see what you're saying.
A couple of them say they couldn't hear you, and I don't know if I'm covering the speakers, but I'm just moving this out the way.
Yeah, moving out the way, Doc.
Yeah.
So as I was saying before, I was rudely interrupted by the host.
Yeah, I was not. Was you able to hear everything he said? Because I don't know why y'all said he not talking in the mic, but this is Facebook Live.
Right. You want me to do this?
This Facebook Live, you're not going to hear that mic on
right,
Facebook
Live. Right,
you're
not going to hear this mic. That's another
program.
What was I saying?
Okay, go
ahead. Because Sherry Sharper.
I'm sorry. Go forward. I forgot what you said. Oh, about the pastor knowing you.
Yeah. See, everybody can't be a preacher.
Mm-hmm.
And count someone in the office and then step out in the audience and call it prayer line. And then that same brother who you counsel in the office, who you know some stuff or their struggles, can you effectively still stand there and pray for them?
Right.
So I say sometimes it's best to just go elsewhere.
Yes, sir.
On the other side of town.
Yep.
To talk to someone who don't know you.
Don't know you.
Who can help you,
mm-hmm.
and then go back to where you got to go, because everybody just don't have that confidentiality.
They don't.
And everybody just can't respect you and look at you the right way in the morning.
That's true. The right way in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
Touch me in the morning. Then just
don't finish.
The words.
Don't finish.
The song.
Don't finish.
yeah. So we were kind of talking around the subject here because we were waiting on the great...
Not going to make it.
He not going to make it?
Daughter's in the hospital.
Oh, okay. Well, then let's keep talking.
Just text me.
I see Elder Gibson right here. He's one of the ones that's Rodney not talking in the mic. he on Facebook Live.
Ain't
and
that
I am
something?
Waiting on him to come
waiting
in.
Waiting on him.
Boy. Betsy Ortiz, y'all. You here.
Hey, my girl.
We love her. Okay.
I like her.
All right, then. So we were 12. Okay, he says... I do also.
What?
Okay, now they said, and greater works than these things he's talking about, everything he did, because I go unto my Father. Now he says, while I'm here, you won't be able to do great works.
Right.
This is the way it seems like he's alluding to.
Right.
He says, but now your work is going to be greater because now I'm leaving here.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to take care of something so that you can.
Yeah. See, I'm out of the way. You won't have this distraction, or you won't be leaning on me to do everything.
Right. But there's three key things we got to look at. There's three keys. Three key words.
Three keys.
In this particular passage, as my friends say,
mm-hmm.
passage of Scripper. There's three key words in here. Word number one is believeth.
Yes.
Word number two is greater.
Mm-hmm.
And word number three would be works.
Okay.
Those are three key words.
Mm.
And in the, we'll probably get to it based on how soon you want to get into this.
Okay.
And ever. But those are three key words. I will say this, that every miracle Jesus performed, he performed the miracles for a particular reason.
He did.
He didn't just perform a miracle just to be performing it.
Right.
And then you have to understand, every miracle that he performed because it was needed.
Right.
Okay. And then when you see that miracles that were performed on people, look at what the crowd did.
Yeah.
The Bible said, and they began to praise God.
Yeah.
So in other words, when a miracle is performed, it's performed on a person who is in need of one, number one.
Uh-huh.
Then it ought to bring glory to God.
Right.
And then two or three, the people around it began to praise God when they saw the miracle.
Mm-hmm.
And so did the person who received the miracle.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it looks like none of them were excited as we would like people to be if you read it.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe that they were all more excited. Now, when you get to the town of Bethsaida,
mm-hmm.
Now, that's the one where Jesus did all those miracles, but he was upset with them.
Sure.
Mark 8:22. He said, because I did all of that to them, but they refused to repent.
Ooh wee.
Yeah.
I'm telling.
Yeah.
And I see Mama on here, so I'm really telling. Mama, get your son.
Hey, Mama.
Sharpa said she had her volume turned down. It was on her end.
See?
You know what I'm saying? She's not as sharp as we thought then.
No. She mm-hmm. was sharper, she, so she's sharpless.
She's Sherry Sharpless.
Yes. Sherry Sharpless.
Yeah. Avos Nana says, but that's one of the reasons for sending the comforter. Absolutely.
What?
Well, him leaving.
Uh-huh.
He said, but I'm not going to leave you comfortless.
Right. I'm not going to leave you as an orphan. I'm not going to leave you in the dark.
Nope, not going to do it.
Right.
Because I came here. Now you're used to something.
Right.
So I'm gonna give y'all my residue. Mm-hmm. Deatrice says, prophets, and she spelled it P-R-O-F-I-T-S, will say, I see you do something. Or say, I see you need a blessing. Well,
both is always true.
Right, who's not going through something or who's
going to need a blessing?
Beatrice! Okay, Flores says, generally, people who think they should be counseled by someone they do know are in a position for not receiving the necessary help they need and don't realize.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. Yeah, that is so true.
If you're going to go to a counselor, you need to go to someone who can help you.
Yes, absolutely.
And sometimes the one who you think can really can't.
Cannot help you.
And I'm going to be honest with you. Just because he is your pastor and or a preacher doesn't mean that he have the right answers that you may need.
True.
Because I hate to say it. A lot of our pastors don't, or preachers. I'm going to stick with preachers.
Yes, say that.
They don't operate through the Spirit or through the anointing.
Right.
Now, you can operate under the anointing of God and you don't need a bachelor's degree.
True.
You can operate under the Holy Ghost and you don't need to be a theologian.
Right.
But you have to be operating under the Holy Ghost and be sensitive to the move of the Spirit of God and allow the Holy Ghost to tell you what to tell this person.
Yeah.
A lot of cases, we just tell people what we feel.
Sure.
Or we scratching at the air, trying to find a solution for this person. And what we do in a lot of cases is we just do more damage.
We do more damage. That's so true. Well, Christopher says something here. This is, let me switch this over. this thing a little slow today. Hope it don't cut me off. Okay, Christopher, I call him Iron Man, by the way.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Christopher Simpson and Elder Gibson going back and forth. Uh-oh.
Ooh.
He says, Christopher says, wasn't miracles done just to gain their attention?
Whose attention?
Christopher says that. I don't know. Then he says, so that the word could land on fertile ground. And Elder Gibbon says, no, that's not true.
No, because the person needed the miracle.
Yes.
So it could not have been done just for attention. Not even when he's referring to when Jesus looked around them and saw them and he got a little angry with them. Because at first he said, man, your sins are forgiven.
Sure.
So then they upset. Who can forgive sins but God?
Right, right.
So then the Bible said that Jesus, when he looked on them, then he said, you healed.
Mm-hmm.
But I still stick with every miracle that was performed was a miracle that was needed to be performed.
For that person first.
For that person first. Then number two, it brings glory to God.
Yes.
Number three, it proves that Jesus is the Son of God.
Right.
And then number four, it calls the others to glorify God.
Right.
Or at least recognize that Jesus is the Son of God.
That's good.
Based on John 14 and 12.
There it is. And I see where Iron Man is going here. I just think that the word just might be
right.
misleading in a sense because he says, wasn't it miracles done just to gain their attention? Well, it obviously gained their attention.
Yes. Oh, yes.
But that wasn't the reason why he didn't really need to prove that through that miracle, through that healing of somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because there are other things he could have done. But. Well, he said miracles. So it could have been the healing, could have been the feeding, the 5,000, okay, whatever the miracle is.
But now, it wasn't every miracle that was performed helped a human. So
even though he used sometimes nature and animals.
Right, but it still helped
a human. Yes.
So now there were, to my knowledge, there were miracles that was done where it did not profit a human being.
Right.
So he could have performed a miracle and just made a tree move, but it would not have profited a human being.
Absolutely.
So every miracle that he did, he performed it on someone who was in need of a miracle.
They were in need of it. Mm-hmm. Right. So to be technical, Christopher, I see where he's going.
Yeah, I understand what he's saying.
And if you was a good lawyer, you'd say he's right.
Yeah. Right.
Okay, because he did it to get their attention, that he is
the, he is Lord.
He is Lord.
He's the Son of God.
And he's able to heal them too. So that I can reiterate what I said earlier. Mm-hmm. Okay? Because he did it to get attention. Mm-hmm. But I like the 4 points you made. I think it's 4 points.
Mm-hmm.
They were great points. Y'all rewind Spricker. You hear?
Yes, yes.
Okay, because I ain't got time.
Right. And I don't remember.
You see what I'm saying? That's the anointing.
Yes, sir.
Because when you don't remember, that's the anointing. Verse 9 says, God sends his most profound revelation through people you don't know or even like. She's saying. That's true, too.
Who said that?
Verse 9 said that. Because God used the enemy to teach you a lesson.
Yes.
You don't like the enemy. He wouldn't be going in on me.
That's right.
Okay.
Or enema, okay.
But right. he used the enemy to bless and curse you.
Yes, sir.
All right. You don't like them, but the wealth of the
wicked
is stored up for me.
Mm-hmm.
Come on down, Trump. Mm-hmm. Give me some of that. Dietra says, yes, bless you, Pastor. Many are jumping ahead of Holy Ghost. I think she's referring to you.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Lady Rochelle Matheny says, these so-called prophets can fix their mouth to say what you want to hear. How can we decipher what is really from God? Not sure if you covered this. Well, we covered it. We covered this a lot, but to answer for the new listeners out there.
Right.
Help her out.
It's not very difficult. We have to be sensitive to the move of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
See, the Bible speaks that out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you look in the book of 1 Corinthians, it talks about prophesying.
Yes.
Paul said, if you're going to prophesy, prophesy in order.
Yeah.
One prophesy and wait. Then let someone else prophesy, but then let there be a judge. Judges must be around.
Yes.
In other words, when someone is prophesying, if it is of God, God has a witness there in the room.
Mm-hmm.
If you're in a local assembly or if you're in church or whatever the case may be, I believe that God has a witness there. That there have been many times when either my brother, Elder Duane or Jarvis or someone has spoken something and it was in my spirit, and I would holler either amen or I agree.
Right.
Now, that's the time you holler amen.
Mm-hmm.
Because amen means so be it,
yes.
And or I agree, or I'm a witness to what he's saying is correct.
Right.
So if the person that's standing before the prophet has the Spirit of God, if the person who's prophesying is prophesying something that's not true, the Spirit of God and the person receiving the prophecy ought to move this individual that what this person is saying is out of order.
That's true. Yeah. I hope that made sense, Lady Rochelle.
Plus, he says, try the Spirit, and you have to try his Spirit by God.
And not by the Spirit.
Not by the Spirit.
Yeah, we're always quoting that.
Right. Yeah, we always said try the Spirit by the Spirit. No, he just said try the spirits, whether they are of God.
Right.
So make sure that whatever this person is saying is biblical.
Yes, sir.
And then be careful that they don't use just the King James language to pull something over your head. Mm-hmm.
And they do that a lot because a lot of times they know. See, Satan knows you don't really know scriptures.
Exactly.
So he'll use one of your brothers.
Yeah. And then I say, stop being in a hurry to always run to the prophet anyhow.
Yes, please stop.
Get on your own knees.
Yeah.
And seek God for yourself.
For yourself. Get it for yourself.
And study your word of God daily.
Yes, 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 yes.
And he'll give you your answer.
She said very clear. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Bronian Scott says, I will never believe in. Okay, I cannot read her stuff on the air.
I was waiting on her. Bronia, this is your conscience speaking.
So I'm going to let y'all read that for yourself. Deidre says, great teaching. Even Spricker. I know y'all can't see it, but read it in the anointing.
Right.
I'm surely taking notes. Ooh. Amen.
I'll have to see what she wrote in the spirit.
Yeah, see what she's writing in the spirit. Try the spirit by a Bronia spirit. Woo, boy, girl, right there.
I think her and Iron Man need to meet.
Her and Iron Man, boy.
Yeah.
They something
they
else.
They need to start their own church.
They need to start their own church. Lord have mercy. Okay, going to my father. Now, verse 13.
Mm-hmm.
And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name.
Name. Mm-hmm.
Number here it one. Go. Here it go.
Here it is.
Whatever you ask in my name.
My name.
Okay, what is his name, though?
That's a very good question.
All right, because
we only know his earthly name.
Yeah, and what is that?
And his earthly name is mm-hmm. earthly title.
Okay, that's his earthly title.
Uh-huh.
And some battle or differ.
Yeah.
Because they look at the etymology of where that come from. Some say it come from Zeus, and some, you know, Christopher know where
yeah,
I'm going here.
I
right?
don't care what they say.
We're going there. Yeah. Okay, and then we see other names that he's called.
Oh, yeah, there's plenty of names in the Bible.
Plenty of names in Scripture, mm-hmm. and then he went to the disciples, and he asked them, who do men say I am?
Who do they say I am?
And some say Jeremiah.
Right.
Some say Isaiah.
Mm-hmm. One of the prophets.
They said Isaiah, mm-hmm. and one of the prophets, okay?
The Baptist.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And of course, we know that the Bible says that his name should be called Emmanuel.
Right, meaning okay? God with us.
Which fixes what Jesus said out of his own mouth, what mm-hmm. we just read here. You mm-hmm. see me, you see the Father. So that's what my name is, Emmanuel.
God with us.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, if we're talking to a Jewish audience, if we're talking to a Mid-Eastern audience, they won't say Jesus, may say Yahshua.
Yahshua.
Okay. So, mm-hmm. so it, or if you're talking to maybe a Hispanic, he may say Jesus.
Jesus.
Okay. Or a Chinese or whatever, they might say Isis.
Isis.
Okay. All right. All these names. All right.
Right.
So, at the name of Jesus for us,
mm-hmm.
Yahshua for them,
mm-hmm.
Isis for that person, mm-hmm. okay, and on and on and on. Still the same name in interpretation.
In interpretation, in okay. your own language.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. So, once you realize what his name is in mm-hmm. your language
in your
and understanding,
language. Uh-huh.
he says, now,
you can ask.
You ask in my name,
mm-hmm.
that will I do.
He's going to do it.
I'm going to do
it. Whatever you ask.
That the Father may be glorified
where?
In the Son.
In the Son.
Yes.
See, there's two things of glorification. Mm-hmm. Number one, the Father is glorified in the Son.
Yes.
And then number two, the Son is glorified.
Okay.
It's just like healing.
Mm-hmm.
Healing is the glory of God.
Yes.
But then healing brings glory to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
So when he was standing there at the gravesite of Lazarus,
yes.
Jesus tells Lazarus' sister, didn't I tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?
Right.
Now, what is the glory of God? What was it that Lazarus' sister wanted to happen?
Mm-hmm.
She wanted her brother raised from the dead.
Yes.
Or she wanted brother to be healed.
Right.
So Jesus said, didn't I tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God, which lets me know that healing is glory of God. But when it takes place, it brings glory to Jesus because he died for healing.
Mm.
So I stop just asking God to heal me. I start saying, Father, glorify your Son in my body.
Ooh.
So when I get healed, healing is the glory of God. And when I get healed, then it brings glory to Jesus because he died for me to be healed.
Yes, sir.
Then why am I sick? He can get glory as long as I'm sick.
Oh.
And his glory cannot be revealed in my life as long as I'm walking around sick.
Ooh.
So I say, Father, glorify your Son in my life.
Wow.
Or in my body.
Or in my body.
Whenever he heals me, it brings glory to who Jesus is.
Yeah. Yeah. You're getting some likes here. I don't know why they liking you.
I want some love.
All this like stuff. I want
some love.
Christopher Simpson, Iron Man is saying out of John 6:30, what do you say? They asked for another sign, but Jesus didn't give them one.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, he told them that they needed to focus on him and what he said rather than on the signs.
True.
The sign he had already given them was intended to teach them about him,
mm-hmm.
and they would listen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you know where he going with this?
Mm-mm.
Okay, I don't know either.
He may be dealing with the miracles again.
Okay.
Because I believe somewhere, what if the Bible says something was a sign? Did it say tongues or miracles? Mm-hmm. One is a sign for the unbeliever.
Oh, the tongues is a sign.
Tongues is a sign.
For the unbeliever.
For the unbeliever.
Which, okay, go ahead, because I want to finish that statement bad.
I'm going to leave it alone. I'm going to just sip my tea over here, me and Kermit.
Yeah. See, and that's the problem, bro.
Uh-huh. Well, sipping tea with Kermit?
Well, that too, but tongues is a sign
uh-huh.
for the unbeliever. Uh-huh. Now, the prophecy was assigned for the believer. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is in scripture, mm-hmm. as I can recall.
Yes, yes.
So we spend too much time giving tongues to a room full of believers, mm-hmm. but Apostle Paul was very, very strict about this. He's very expressive, as the scripture says. Mm-hmm. He says, because when an unbeliever hear his language, mm-hmm. that you're speaking in a different tongue, mm-hmm. then he becomes a believer.
True.
That's why the tongue is
a sign.
It's a sign for the unbeliever.
And he didn't say unknown tongues.
Right.
He just said tongues, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. which means language.
Yes, sir.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Okay. So it's a tongue that I understand. Mm-hmm. In Acts 2, they spoke in tongues.
Other tongues.
That other people understood.
Right. 1 Corinthians 14, they spoke in unknown tongues. And Jesus said in Mark 16, 18, something like that, they will speak with new tongues.
Yes. Yes.
So we just got to get the tongues correct.
We just got to get these tongues correct.
Right.
Okay. And so we hear more tongues among the believers. Mm-hmm. But.
I just hate to say it. A lot of it is just a show.
It's a lot of show.
It's a show and it's just emotional.
It's repetitive and you can understand.
Yeah, you're going to
understand. You borrow tongues from the church.
And you know exactly what
what they're going to say. Okay. You hear these tongues and you understand them now. So now all of us are really multilingual because we understand a lot of these.
they
just recycled. Okay, recycled.
Right.
All right. But the Apostle Paul says, but I'd rather that you prophesy.
You prophesy.
Yet we're not doing a lot of that within our bodies. We're calling the evangelist from across
town to prophesy.
To prophesy to us.
And to prophesy simply means mm-hmm. to speak what God says speak.
Yes, that's all it means.
That's all it means.
Right.
To speak this. Mm-hmm. It's not that the prophet is some great orator.
Right.
You know? But I believe that the prophet is one who should be laid out before God all of the time.
He should always be laid out.
Yes. Yeah. But we forget that there are fivefold in this ministry.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. We don't want to be the teacher.
Yeah.
Forget the evangelist mm-hmm, mm-hmm. and the district missionary.
And the district district missionary. Be careful. You got to raise an offering if you say your name.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. So whatsoever you shall ask in my name.
We
got the names right.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That will I do.
He's going to do it.
I'm going to do it.
Right. Now, who is it that you have to ask?
What do you mean?
See, when we pray, Jesus told us specifically who to pray to.
Yes, sir. Okay. So, good question. Oh,
yeah.
Good question right there, boy. Yeah.
We may find out why we ain't getting no answers because you're asking the wrong individual.
Let's go back then.
The old landmark.
Yeah, because in the book of John, he made this clear mm-hmm. in different, you know, line upon line, precept upon precept. Mm-hmm. Because he said, y'all looking through the scriptures, he says, but you're looking for eternal life through mm-hmm. the scriptures, he says, but you're finding me. Mm-hmm. Okay. But then another place it says, it is the Father which draw you
to me. Uh-huh.
But
nobody comes to my Father,
to the Father except
but by me.
Through right.
Mm-hmm.
Now what the Holy Ghost have to do this?
Because the Holy Ghost is the drawing agent. He's the agent that's being used to do all of the work.
And you can't call Lord Lord without it. All right? So what mama saying? We both messages from mama.
And when mama talks, we all stop.
Yeah, I was not a. You said you can't hear. You heard earlier. I don't know what happened. That might be y'all's phone because everybody else said they can hear. I think they're saying we can hear. Okay, so I have to ask you a question. Mm-hmm. This is what do you all think about organized prophet training or prophet university? Okay, we'll touch that in a minute. Mm-hmm. So by his name, what was your question again?
Well, who do you pray to?
Oh, there it is. Okay. Mm-hmm. So if we're praying, a lot of times the average Christian prays to Jesus, I hear, mm-hmm. and then we'll even end it in Jesus' name.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems perplexed, though, because mm-hmm. I don't think we really focused on that yet. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Deidre. She said she can hear. So obviously that's your phone.
Yeah, them track phones.
Them track phones. Stay out of Walmart.
Yes. Go to Walgreens.
We supposed to be. Matter of fact, Jesus told us how to pray.
Yes, he did.
He says, in this manner.
In this manner, pray.
Pray like this.
Uh-huh.
Our Father.
That's the one you pray to.
That's who you pray to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because it is the Father who was working through Jesus.
That's the key point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we always focus on Jesus in the prayer.
Right. And then we always say, well, I'm not Jesus. I can't do what he did. Yes, you can.
Yeah.
He just specifically said, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth. Mm-hmm. Key word is believeth.
Yes.
And we'll deal with that when we get to it, but key word is believeth.
Right.
Then he says, the works that I do shall you do also.
Right.
But see, we're missing something when we just read that. Mm-hmm. Because he said something prior to that, and then he said something after that.
Yeah.
But since we're on praying in a name, he says that we are to pray to the Father.
Mm-hmm.
Hey. Because everything is hinged on the Father.
Everything is hinged on the Father.
Everything.
He's a henchman.
He's a So when we pray, we're praying to God.
Right.
But we're praying in the name of Jesus.
Uh-huh.
Now, I ask a question. Do I always have to say in the name of Jesus?
Right.
Or is it a known by God that
right.
I'm standing firm
yes.
on the name of his son?
Yes, yes. That's
because
good.
When I come to represent him, matter of fact, we call it power of attorney.
Yes.
Jesus gave us power of attorney.
Right.
In the name of Jesus.
Right.
He gave us this power of attorney.
Yeah.
He gave us all the rights. But the key thing is, whatever we ask God in the name of Jesus, it has to be something that's according to the will of God.
The will of God.
Yeah.
Aha.
You can't ask him for nothing that's not the will of God.
Okay, okay. Flora says both. So I don't know what you mean by both, Flora. You mean who do we pray to, Father or Christ himself?
Probably is, yeah. Well, okay. Jesus told us. You pray yeah. to the Father.
To the Father.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
By the power of the Holy Ghost.
By the power. So you pray to one, you're praying to them all
yes.
because you can't separate them.
Exactly.
Okay, well, you just can't do it.
Right. But we pray for Jesus mm-hmm. and the Holy Ghost mm-hmm. to assist us.
Yes.
Because Romans says that we don't know what to pray for as we ought.
Yes.
But the Spirit itself helpeth.
Uh-huh.
Us.
Yes.
So while we're praying to God, mm-hmm. the Holy Spirit also makes intercession for us.
Yes.
At the same time.
Right.
Matter of fact, he's faster than us. He didn't came back with the answer. Why are you still praying?
Why are you still praying? Okay. With moans or groans. Okay.
With groanings that cannot be uttered.
Now, we're not talking about tongues.
Right. Not talking about tongues.
We always mess that up.
Right. It's the Holy Spirit that has a conversation with
yes.
God
yes.
that you don't know nothing of.
Right. Exactly.
And he's not using your body.
No.
See, he's making groanings.
Right.
So we think it's tongues. Well, what happens when you don't speak in tongues
exactly.
when you're praying?
Absolutely. What if you're mute?
Yeah, what if you're mute?
Yes.
So it has to
yes.
put it on the unmute.
Put it on the unmute.
Unless you're in church.
Yes.
Yeah. But the key thing is Jesus says, first of all, that everything is about the Father.
Yeah.
So he's the head of everything.
Right.
Now, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians that all things is put under the feet of Jesus except God.
Yes.
Then when all of this is all done and said, the Bible says Jesus himself is going to submit himself under God again.
Mm. Mm.
So everything is centered around God,
yes.
but Jesus is a representative of God. And now the Holy Ghost is a representative of Jesus.
Yes.
So each represents the other and speaks of the other and is empowered by the other. Everything Jesus did, he did by the power of the Holy Ghost.
By the power of the Holy Ghost. Flora says, either way, you are honoring the presence and deity of Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. So when you're praying to the Father, Jesus is sitting on the right hand.
Yes, sir.
And the Father looks over at Jesus and says, is he worthy?
Yes. Not only that,
mm-hmm.
but he says, is this something that you died for?
Yeah, there it is.
See, because any and everything we ask God for has to be something that was dealt with on the cross.
There it is. Yeah, who does the remote farmer in a distant land pray to that never heard Jesus? That man, you on another. This is Christopher. You knew that, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, who? So, tell him to go to Romans, the first chapter.
Yes, exactly. Thank you, sir.
That every man has some image.
There is no excuse
of God in him.
Yes,
and something in him
mm-hmm.
says. When he see the stars, the yes. sun, the moon, Elder Gibson with glasses, he knows
yes. yeah.
that there is a God.
Yes.
That's what Romans said, right?
Yes.
Every man knows it.
Yeah.
The key thing is we're supposed to be able to point to him where God is.
Yes.
Now, I heard Barbara Amos, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. Bishop.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Barbara Amos.
Put a respect on.
Please forgive me.
Uh-huh.
So I got to put a praise. So she said cigarettes is not the problem.
And Christopher agreed with that. Oh, wow. Boy, you don't win. Hey, where's my piano? I need a Hammond organ. Give me a Hammond organ. Iron Man.
So she says that drugs is not the problem.
Okay.
Drugs is the person's solution to the problem.
That's good.
If you find the problem, you'll get rid of the drugs.
Yes, sir.
This is where the preacher comes along and tells them Jesus is the answer.
Yes, sir.
For the world today.
Yes.
When we point them to Christ, then we eliminate all these other problems that they have.
Yeah. Maurice E. Gregory, the preacher.
Hey, that's my brother.
I love that man. He says Elder Gibson with glasses. He got you, Doc Gibson. He got you, man. He got you.
And that's a good preacher.
That's a great preacher. What are you talking about?
Him and Elder Gibson. Elder Gibson is a revivalist.
Yeah.
That man can preach a revival.
Oh, I saw his video.
And Maurice Gregory, man paid out.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, you do. You just don't know.
I sure don't.
Folk got stuff on you.
Yeah, good stuff.
I almost got saved twice.
Twice?
Yeah.
Almost persuaded me.
I was almost persuaded. I said, that Negro is preaching. Yeah, man. Christopher Samson, but do he have to pray in the name of Jesus is my question.
Who? He who?
The one that's on
whoever's praying.
Whoever's praying.
Do we have to say the name of Jesus? Because I think you were alluding to that earlier.
I said it. Yeah. See, the thing is, the words.
Yeah.
Okay. He says, in my name shall you cast out devils. Mm-hmm. It doesn't necessarily mean that you really have to really speak his name.
Right.
Whoever you're coming against already know that you're standing there in his name.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So your attorney does not always say blah, blah, blah. The judge automatically knows he's representing you right off the bat.
Yes.
So we don't always have to use the word in the name of Jesus because God already knows we're standing there on his word. Yes, it's good to use his word, his name.
Yes.
I'm not saying not to, but like you said, suppose you're mute.
Yes, absolutely.
So you can't even speak the words, but you're still standing on his word.
And there becomes a fear that because I didn't say it, now this is not going to work.
Exactly.
It's like praying over your food, Gibson.
Right.
It's like, uh-oh, and I ate his food, didn't pray.
Right.
Now I'm going to be poisoned or something. God's going to punish me.
And then I didn't say, in the name of
Jesus. So I think we got caught up in the tradition of things.
Right.
And it becomes almost, what's the thing you do when you're going on the ladder or not going on the ladder?
Superstitious.
Yeah, it becomes superstitious. For instance, some of us feel like we can't leave service except we stay for the dismissal prayer.
Right.
The person usually who's praying usually use that against y'all.
Oh,
says,
yeah.
Don't
go
out
the door, blah, blah, blah. Yeah,
because something may happen to you. You got to hear this prayer.
Right, right.
And which is also, it's borderline manipulation.
Oh, yes, witchcraft.
Okay, witchcraft, because what happened to the people who had to leave earlier?
Right.
Is something bad going to happen to them now because you didn't hear the dismissal prayer?
Let me ask you a question. Whose name did Jesus cast out the devil that the man's son had?
Whose name, what's his name?
When the man had the devil, his son had all those demons in him, and the disciples couldn't do it.
Yes.
Did Jesus call that devil out?
Yeah.
Now, whose name did he use?
Well, the demon, and if this is the same
whose
one.
Whose name did Jesus use?
Yeah, well, he asked the question, who are you?
Yeah.
Okay, I might be on two different
occasions. Yeah, you are two different. The one where he said, this kind cometh not forth.
Oh, that one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whose name did Jesus use?
Out of the devil?
Whose name did Jesus cast this devil out with? Did Jesus say, I cast you out by the name of God?
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Nope.
So he didn't. Matter of fact, you rarely even see where he used that terminology.
Right.
Yet, any demon he came up against knew who he was representing when he got there.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Brother, any and every demon he came up against knew. Matter of fact, when he went in the temple, they started crying out, wow, you come against us before it's time. Jesus ain't even said nothing.
That's so true. The Bible says when they saw him approaching, that's that. He got, hey, Marisa, Gregory, he got them glasses. His eyes went. His eyes.
It's on like a pot of chicken.
It's on, Rachel. Y'all. It's on.
Your rate is about to go sky high.
Yes, sir.
Y'all going to have to stop paying for the show time.
But that is so true. In every situation, when the demons saw Christ, they recognized him.
Right. Why did they recognize
him? They knew him from the beginning, first of all.
Yeah.
Okay, they knew him. They knew his work.
Right.
All right.
Now, point on the speaker.
Yes, sir.
Now, if we look at something, Christ never did anything without the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Now, remember, he said, the words that I speak, I'm speaking the words that my Father told me to speak. Right?
Yes.
So why is it that we cannot subject ourselves to the words that the Holy Ghost is telling us to speak?
I don't know.
So when we subject ourselves to speak what the Holy Ghost tells us to speak, whatever we comes against automatically know that we're represented. And I'm not saying don't use the name of Jesus. Right. I use his name.
Yes, I
stand on his name, but live in his name as well. Don't just walk up, I bind you in the name of, I decree and declare. Baby, you probably want to go somewhere and sit down because you don't want that devil to tell you, Paul, I know.
Yes.
Gibson, I know. Rodney, I know. I know Cece. I met her the other day.
But we was in the bar, but I know her.
I know her from the bar.
I know her from the bar. But I know her.
let me say this, because you asked the question, what name did Jesus use when he cast out the spirit? Mm-hmm. Well, you're dealing with the actual person of Christ.
Okay.
The actual person of Christ, him in the flesh, God in the flesh. Of course, they're going to know him, and they're subject to him. We, on the other hand, we're not God in the flesh. So therefore, I didn't understand. That's why I didn't quite agree.
True. Oh, yeah. Good. Beautiful. Now, what did Paul say? It's not I.
Right.
But the Christ that lives within me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, he's no longer in the flesh, but yet now he's within us. So when we come against the enemy, we ought to see the Christ that's in us, that's telling us what to say to this enemy. Oh, yeah, I stand firm on what you're saying. I know. But remember what I said. Yes, they were talking to Jesus in the flesh, but they were still also talking to a man who the Bible said that Jesus didn't do anything without the Holy Ghost.
That's so true.
So it is the Holy Ghost that led him.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, when he went into the wilderness, the Bible said he was driven by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted.
Yes, that's true.
Then, I don't know, Acts or something like that, maybe the first chapter, it said that after he threw the Holy Ghost, he gave commandments to the apostles, which basically lets us know he didn't do nothing without the Holy Ghost.
True.
Anywhere he went, everywhere he went, and the things that he did was through the power of the Holy Ghost. And then he left us, 1 Peter, I think, says, he left us. He was an example.
Right.
So that's why I asked the question, are we limited or can we do everything that Christ did?
Yeah. We're about to go there, y'all. This is a very important question that he's asking, and I hope that y'all have the answers here because y'all are going there. Okay, Marisa Gregory says two different demons. That's right. The demon that I'm talking about was the one when he walked up to him and asked him, okay, who are you?
Right.
And they says, we're legion.
We're legions. Right.
The many.
Exactly.
Okay. Right. So there's two.
The other one was his cousin.
Right. Exactly. But my point is, all demons recognize Christ.
From afar off.
They know him.
Yes.
Why they don't recognize y'all? I don't get it.
Well, the glasses that they wear.
Maybe we didn't have our glasses on.
Right. I didn't have a choir robe on.
I remember one instance, and I oftentimes.
30 seconds.
Yeah, because the music.
You hear the music, that means 30 seconds. He don't hear the music. He ain't got it. Make your point after this break.
We'll make it after break.
Okay. These new guys cutting my shirt. Yeah, I don't get it.
He got it in his hand like
okay.
This.
Okay. When I come back from the break, this is going to play just a commercial. I don't have any news. All right? Just play a commercial and come right back because my news didn't come in yet. I've been checking my email. When I come back, we're going to ask. We're going to find out what the Dr. Gibson's getting ready to say. And then I'm going to ask y'all, can we pray to the angel? Can we communicate with the angels? Okay? All right? Great question. Hope you have a good answer. So, Walter Jones, show.
Log on to UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered.
Love, glory, and inspiration 24 hours a day. UBM Praise Chicago, a service of the UBM Networks.
The following show is paid program and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
So while the Jones Show, turn on a light from heaven, Lord, shine on me, shine on me. As amen. Hey, we with the brothers here, the great Elder Gibson and the good doctor, Elder Rodney Jones, and they were getting ready to disagree. Continue with the disagreement here.
No, actually, it wasn't a disagreement.
Yes, well, stop playing with me.
Not on this point that I'm about to.
Right. The okay. Next point will be.
The next one, right.
All right, the next one, right. Okay, so, Dr. Gibson, before with the break, you getting ready to make a point. What was that point?
I remember working on a particular job in the mall, and a young mother had a child that was acting out. I mean, hollering, piercing. And immediately my discernment kicked in and said, okay, this boy got a demon.
CC, the music.
All right. And the boy, the mother and the son was across the mall from where I was located in the mall. And I said, sitting right where I was, I said, in the name of Jesus, mm-hmm. I bind you. When I said that within myself, the boy stopped what he was doing and looked past everyone and made eye contact with me. Mm-hmm. That's the power and authority that we should be operating
should
in.
Be. That's right. Mm-hmm.
And if we don't have that type of authority to come against spirit, see, a lot of times we think because the power lies in how loud we rebuke the devil.
Right.
No, he don't care how loud. You can say it on a megaphone with a microphone.
Thank you, sir.
That don't mean nothing to him.
Thank you.
You have to have the power and authority of mm-hmm. the Holy Ghost operating in you. Mm-hmm. And the discernment to know what spirit is operating in the person that's possessed, oppressed, however you want to term it, that's operating in the person. Mm-hmm. And if we can come into church, here we go. If we can come to church and see and allow the spirit to show us what people are operating with, what spirit is operating in people, mm-hmm. I do believe that a lot of stuff won't happen and go on in church that goes on in church.
True.
Because we are operating in a spirit of discernment, and with now we are not only with a spiritual of discernment, but we're going to operate with power and authority to rebuke it. For instance, this Jezebel spirit that's running rapping in church.
Yes, sir.
It can operate boldly.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Mm. No one is standing up in authority to mm-hmm. confront it.
True.
And the reason why Jezebel was confronted in the Bible, because watch this, Elijah, the spirit of Elijah confronted the spirit of Jezebel.
Right.
Mm-hmm. When he confronted the spirit of Jezebel, Jezebel mm-hmm. now has to take flight.
Mm-hmm.
And if we as people of God, men of God, women of God, operate in the spirit and authority that God has given us, of course we can do some things like Jesus. We can do greater works. Now, to the fact of the greater works, what is the greater works?
No, you were talking about going to another person.
No, I'm going to come back to that.
Okay.
I'm like a preacher.
Well, we right, you are preaching. Yeah, no, that's good. We actually haven't gotten into the greater work yet.
Okay, right. Yeah, okay, well, let me speak to that.
We're still in the foundation. Yeah. Right. Because we're waiting on you.
Yeah, the greater
well,
work.
Well, I'm here now.
Are you here or do we look for another to come?
Is there another? Yeah.
Now, I remember when I was going through some difficult times, I went to someone that I knew loved me enough to tell me the truth.
Mm. There's only a couple of people like that.
And so I think you can go to someone that you know, but they got to be a person that's willing to love you enough to tell you the truth, even if the truth hurts you.
And them.
And them. Mm-hmm. Because I went to someone that knew me, knew all about me, but they loved me enough to say, you know what, I'm not going to go along with what you're saying. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to go along with what you're doing. And they set me down and just ripped me apart. Mm-hmm. And I took that, what they said, and I ran with it.
Yeah.
So not all the time you have to go to someone that you don't know. Mm-hmm. A lot of times we go to folks that we don't know because we figure they hold us accountable because they don't know us. Right. But if you go to someone that loves you enough, that cares about your spiritual growth and development, they will tell you the truth and then trying to hold you accountable. Mm-hmm. I think that's one of the biggest things that's lacking in our churches is accountability.
Of course. Yes.
And so if you have accountability from if I come to say, Rodney, hey, I got this, and you give me some, you now know what I'm dealing with. Now you call me up and say, Brother Gibson, what's going on?
Right.
Now you holding me accountable
for
what I've done or what I'm going to
do. That's right.
Yeah, let me speak to that. I don't think nobody who spoke on that on here meant that everybody you go to should be someone you didn't know.
Right.
We're talking on certain issues, absolutely. My case was special. Mm-hmm. See, because I was receiving counseling from Bishop Moody all the years I was at that church.
Right.
But this particular case in my marriage, he says, go to this person. Because in this particular case, I can only take you so far.
Right.
Now, when it had to deal with something else.
And that's a man of wisdom.
Yeah, it was a man. Because when it was some other stuff I did, he was the man to counsel me.
Right.
Because the other guy. He couldn't because he don't know the structure maybe of the Church of God in Christ.
Right.
He was a non-denominational man. Mm-hmm. He couldn't help me in that. So I will say though, and now I'm agreeing with Gibson here, is that we see this a lot of times. I'm a member of your church. Mm-hmm. Been there, gosh, for 15 some odd years. Mm-hmm. You know my good and my bad. Mm-hmm. Now I done messed up. Mm-hmm. Now I run the Gibson's church. Mm-hmm. Gibson don't know me. I start working in his church, and then he elevates me to an ecclesiastical position. Okay,
right. State organist.
You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But I messed up at your church
as a bass player.
Yeah, there it is. All right.
Right.
Matter of fact, you sat me down. Silenced me,
and you left.
I left to go to his church. He don't know I got sat down.
Right.
All right. Mm-hmm. So now he done elevated me over the people. Mm-hmm. Now I'm getting ready to do the same thing that I did at your church.
True.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's what strengthens what Gibson is saying. Mm-hmm. I need to be sitting up under you because you can help me because you know what my failure is and my weakness is.
Right.
And you can help me. Mm-hmm. Gibson may not be able to because he don't even know that that this has been in me.
Right.
You know, and there's some specific things that if I see this particular woman, I act this certain way. Exactly. You know that.
Right.
He don't know that. Right. So he put this woman in ministry with me.
Exactly. Right, right. What I'm saying? Team y'all up.
Team us up.
Right.
And we keep messing up. Mm-hmm. But you knew that. Mm-hmm. So that gives strength to what Gibson was saying. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, scripture just says to know them.
That labor among you.
All right.
So I can go so many different ways with what you just said.
Sure.
And I don't want to veer off of this.
Yeah.
But, I think our key thing right now is accountability. Mm-hmm. And that's why we're starting this group of ministers, just a group of men coming together for Bible study and accountability. Mm-hmm. We're going to study the Bible.
Male or female?
I prefer male or male because we're going to talk male things.
I prefer female.
We're going to sit you down.
Right. We're going to silence you. Silence. So the problem is there's no accountability. We were talking about it. Too many of our young preachers now, they don't have no substance. There's no history. There's no food, no staples in their message. And then you just out, just got a microphone giving out information, and the people is getting it, but then it's not something that they can hold on to and take this to live forever, for life. It's not life-changing informational message.
True.
So daily now, I'm asking God, and I ask God, God, give me a fresh word and a fresh anointing.
Sure.
I want to, when I stand before your people, I want to have, number one, a fresh anointing, and then I want to have a fresh word. I want the words that come from you to go through me to your people, because I don't know what they need.
Sure.
You know what they need. And sometimes, Doc, sometimes if I'm preaching and I know brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so is hurting, and I really want to speak to their need, but I don't have permission.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Holy Ghost is saying this, it's not about their brokenness right now. Mm-hmm, it's about my strength.
Mm-hmm, that's good.
You preach my strength.
Yes, sir.
And my Holy Spirit will comfort them, resolve that matter, and empower them right where they're sitting.
That's a great point.
And you ain't got the...
Yes, that's a good point.
It's a done deal.
Because the Apostle Paul had liberty... Well, he had the anointing to go out into lands and witness to people. Yes. And the Holy Ghost stopped him.
So that's right. Told him, you can't go there.
You can't go over there.
Right.
Even though there were people there.
People needed there. Yeah, but needed him there.
It wasn't about them being saved at the moment.
It was about the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, that's good.
And then he ended up in jail.
Yes.
From that whole matter.
From that whole point.
But then he broke out in a celebration. So the word, they sang praises.
Mm-hmm.
I think the Greek is hymnos.
Sure.
And a hymn is a song that celebrates God. Some of the stuff we call a hymn ain't a hymn.
They're not hymns.
A hymn is a song that celebrates God.
Right.
So while they were in hell, in jail, they just broke out in a celebration.
That's good.
And the Bible said that God broke the chains and shook our foundation of the prison.
Yeah.
And that's what we need in church. We need God to shake our foundation.
That's so true.
And he opened up all the doors, not let them out.
Right.
But so that he can come
in. Man, see, now you went there. That's good stuff. Okay? Yep. We always go somewhere. When we try to go, we go somewhere. Because that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Christ came to free us.
Mm-hmm.
But we still have to
want to be free.
We still have to be punished for the things we've done.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I like that, because you said that the chains, okay, the doors open, but that doesn't mean everybody had to be let go free.
Exactly.
Because when they sang praises to the Lord, it says the jailers heard them.
He heard it.
Okay. They heard it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when the thief was on the cross, Christ saved him, but Christ didn't take him off the cross.
Didn't take him off the cross. He still died.
He still had to die.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so there's some things we still have to go through because they're teaching us something.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to promise, ad lib, I see what y'all are saying, the angels thing.
Mm-hmm.
And to the angel.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I see what you're saying, Abby. I see the scripture there. Can we talk? See, is there... How do we define pray? Because if you're talking to a spirit, are you praying?
No, one is talking, and I mean, one is commanding. See,
we
don't pray to angels.
Yes,
we command angels.
Oh, we command them.
We pray to God.
I see. So, because Abby brought up a Revelation 22, that's probably where y'all are going.
No, I'm going to Psalms.
Psalms.
I thought you was a prophet.
Nope, not.
Not today.
Yeah. Because I think what she's referring to when the brother bowed down to the, got on his knees, before the angel says, get up.
Yeah, get up.
That ain't the place.
And that's something we need to understand. Uh-huh. Preachers is not to be ministered to, per se.
Right.
They come to minister.
Yes.
I don't need you bow down to me and give me a cape.
Right.
I came down here to minister to you.
Yeah, that's JB.
Why did we switch the thing around? Why did we make the preacher the king?
Right.
But he's preaching for the King of Kings.
Yeah.
He is not the king.
He's not the king.
You know, here's a man that had enough nerve to say, I don't.
Right.
I'm just like you.
Yeah, I'm a messenger.
I'm just a messenger.
Yeah.
So I'm looking for my scripture. But we pray to God.
Right.
But you have a right in your praying to God to command.
To talk to the angel, because he gives charge.
Because everybody has angels at their beckoning call.
Right.
Now, you're not going to sit up there and you're not going to call the archangel. You're not going to call Michael. You're not going to call Gabriel. Those are God's angels.
Right.
But I can show you later in scripture that we all have angels at our side.
Right.
They've been sent to assist us.
Right.
For those who are called into salvation, something like that the Bible talks about, his ministering spirit.
Sure.
Right. But I'll never forget when they stole my van, and I testify about this from time to time. When they stole my van, I began to challenge the angels, and I said, angels, I command you to move forth. Psalms 103 and 20, the Lord, ye his angels that excel in strength. Mm-hmm. Notice what they do. First of all, they excel.
Mm-hmm.
They're not all the way up there.
Mm.
They excel in strength that do his commandments.
Right.
Okay. They do whatever God tells them. But the next verse, the next phrase says, hearkening unto the voice of his word. Didn't necessarily say hearkening unto the voice of God, but hearkening unto the voice of his word.
Mm-hmm.
And the way I took that is angels move at the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
When we speak the word of God, that's how the angels excel in strength. And then they move according to the word of God that we spoke.
Mm.
Where are you at again?
Psalms 103 and, right, I just closed it. Psalm 103 and... And 20. So what I did was when they stole my van, I says, after I begin to God in the name of Jesus through the power of the Holy Ghost, and then I command the angel that has been sent here to assist me. I said, I command you this day to go get my van, bring my van back today.
Bring it here.
Within 2 hours, the police department called me and says, we found your van. And I got my van back that day.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
I got it back that day. Now, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But I got that from your brother, Elder Dwayne Jones. Yeah. And I stood on it ever since he told me that.
Yeah.
And that's what I believe. And so I begin. So I didn't pray to the angels. I commanded them because there are angels. Everybody has angels at their beckoning call.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
Jesus said, I can call for 12 legions of angels. Now, it is said that he used the word 12 because he had 12 disciples.
Mm.
Meaning the disciple had a legion of angels.
Yes.
Which the disciples represented us, which means we got anywhere from 4,000 to 6,000 angels. That's what a legion is.
Mm-hmm.
At our beckoning call, but they're just sitting there, and they can't excel in strength because we've not given them nothing to do.
We ain't giving nothing. Lord have mercy. Abroni had answered me earlier about 40 minutes ago. She says Jesus gave his names in the gospel according to John. He was referring to the name that God told Moses, I am, is what she said.
Okay, I got you. I got you. Yeah, the I ams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we got that, Bronia. Good answer.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know, that I am got a lot of folk.
Yeah, in trouble.
Yeah, in fact, we got I am. Well, I'm who? So let's continue reading this. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son.
Mm-hmm.
If ye shall ask anything,
in
my name, I will do
it. I'm going to do it. Jesus said he's the one that's going to do it if you ask anything in his name.
Just ask in my name. Ooh, that's a great outro.
Yes.
I know we probably don't have it there, but it's a Thompson Community Singers.
I can sing it. I got you.
Well, I'll mix it in here somehow. That'll be our outro. Just ask my name. And also, CC, I got the news here. So around as I leave the show, I'll do the news. That'll be my outro, my news. How about that? You know, we could do this around here because I am the owner.
Yes. You look like the owner.
Mm-hmm. I am the owner. It said 15 says, if ye love me, keep my commandments. Okay, here we go. Because we can't stop at doing greater things.
No,
In the scripture.
Right.
We got to keep reading because there are conditions.
There are conditions.
Because God is a conditional God. Y'all says, that's not true. Well, then why was he saying in the Old Testament, if you do this, I'll do that.
Right.
So he is conditional. But it says, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Mm-hmm.
And I will pray the Father. Here it is.
Mm-hmm. Now he's praying to the Father as well.
Get ready to say. Uh-huh. He's praying to the Father. And he shall give you another comforter
uh-huh.
that Yeah, that means he was a comforter too. Christ must have been a comforter because he said, I'm going to give you another one.
Yes, which means of the same, the term another means of the same substance,
yes, sir.
Quality, character, everything.
All that. Yeah.
Okay. So whatever the Holy Ghost is what Jesus was.
Yep, another comforter that he may abide with you not till tomorrow.
Forever.
For a long time, y'all. Even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive. Oh, wow. Did you hear that?
Yep. World can't receive him because they can't see him.
They can't see him. They don't understand it. It's a mystery to them.
Oh, yes.
Because it sees him not.
Don't see him.
Neither know him.
Don't know him.
But ye know him.
Uh-huh.
For ye dwelleth with you. Now, he dwelleth with you.
Now, who said dwelling with him?
He.
Which is the Holy
Spirit
Ghost.
Spirit of Truth.
Spirit of Truth, right?
Yes.
He's dwelling with him when? Right now.
Right now, sure.
But he ain't there. But who's there? Jesus.
Right.
But then so he says he dwelleth with you. And then he says, and he shall be in you. Right?
Yep.
So he's talking about himself, but now he's talking about the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Which he's, see, as long as Christ was on the earth. See, we look at Jesus, and the reason why the Christians limit ourselves is because we say we're not Jesus. I have scripture, and I was ready for it, for someone to say, well, we're not the Son of God.
That's not true.
That's not true. That's not how this ends.
It's not how this works.
It's not how none of this works. So, so the problem is, we understand that everything that Jesus did, he did as a human being through the anointing of the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Because the Bible still stands that he said, Peter says, that he was our example.
Yes, sir.
And I don't know about y'all, but when my kids came home with that hard math, you know the first thing I asked them?
What?
Where's the example?
Mm.
Because the example says, number one, this is how it's done.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, you can do it.
You can do it. Yeah,
that's what an example is.
Woo-hoo.
Now, if Jesus is our example, that means whatever he did on earth, I can do it.
Whatever he did.
Whatever he did.
Okay. Whatever he did, I can do. Okay. Well, anything you can do, I can do better.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
I bet I can. So he says, even the gospel truth. All right. Now, 18 says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you.
Yeah.
Yet a little while, and the world sees me no more, but ye see me, because I live, ye shall also live. At that day ye know that I am the Father, and ye in me, and I in you.
I am in the Father.
I'm in him. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father.
Because you keep his commandments in the pudding. You it say is. You love him. But the only way you can prove you love him is you got to keep his commandments.
Keep his commandments.
Yeah.
And I will love him and will manifest
myself
to him. All right. Now, that's all that strengthens everything he said at the beginning of what we started reading in John chapter 14, verse 8. Okay, that strengthened all that. Now, let's go into some details, L. Jones. And
nitty gritty time.
All right. Here we go.
Here we go.
All right, let me see if I missed anything before I go any further. Anybody else here? Natalie Bullock says, wow, there, here's how it's done, and here's how you do it.
Yeah,
that is discipleship in a nutshell.
Yes, sir. That's what an example is, and Jesus was an example. He taught us, number one, that it can be done, and then he taught us, number two, how to do it.
How to do it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, L. Jones. All right. Number one.
Jesus says in verse 10.
Of John
14 and
Yes, sir.
10. Believest thou not that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself. But the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. So right off the bat, Jesus says it's his Father that's doing the work.
Right.
Now, if you go to 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, and it talks about the spiritual gifts.
Yep.
One is the calling. The gifts comes from the Holy Spirit. It's the Lord that brings the operation or puts you in the office. But it said the administration of it. But it's God that gives the energy. It's God that works it all, right? So right off the bat, Jesus is telling them, it's my Father that's doing all of the work. Mm. So right off the bat, that tells me that there was something unique about Jesus that I need to know. It's not that he was doing the works himself. He said that the works that I'm doing, it's my Father that's doing the work.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, my Father is dwelling in me. So it's my Father that's doing the work through me.
Mm-hmm.
So when Jesus stood there and called a dead man out of a grave that's been dead for 4 days, he spoke and it was his Father that raised him up.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
So then number two, he says, believe me that I am in the Father in me, or else believe me for the very works' sake. Now, any man in the Bible that believe the works that Jesus did have to believe that Jesus is the Son of God, because he said that it's his Father that does the work and not necessarily him. Now, we're looking and saying, I can't do what Jesus did because I'm not Jesus. But Jesus told you, I'm not really the one who did the works.
Mm-hmm.
It's my Father that did the works.
Mm-hmm.
So here it is. Number one, he says, if verily, I say unto you, he that believeth. Now, the word believe is the word faith.
Mm-hmm.
Faith comes with the word persuasion. We've got to be fully persuaded. Many of us have faith, but there's some doubt.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have no doubt when you have faith.
Mm-hmm.
You can't have doubt. You cannot have unbelief. Jesus says, if you say that this mountain be removed and don't have doubt in your heart, then that mountain will remove.
Right.
So the word believe means to be fully persuaded in or about, and to be convicted in or convicted of. So he says, he that believeth on me, the works. Now, what were the works? Another word for works here would be the miracles that he did.
Mm-hmm.
What did Jesus do? He healed the dead, or he healed what? The sick.
Mm-hmm.
He raised the dead.
Right.
He walked on water. Mm-hmm. Didn't Peter walk on water?
She did.
Didn't Peter raise a man or a woman from the dead?
Yes.
So basically, every miracle that Jesus performed, somebody in Scripture did it.
Somebody did it.
But they did it through his name. All right? So then he says, the works that I do shall you do in greater, because I go to the Father. We're looking at greater as in a magnitude. In other words, you can't do no more miracles than what Jesus did.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
He had power over nature.
Yes.
So good. He took wine or water. And they tell me I'm not a drinker. Walter, maybe you know. I don't know.
But, I heard.
But they said in order for a wine to really be magnificent, it has to be more than 7 years to be cured or fermented, right?
Right.
He took water and within a matter of seconds and called it to be the greatest wine on earth.
That's right.
So which means he had authority over time, mm-hmm. authority over nature, mm-hmm. authority over death, authority over that. And he says, we got all that same authority
mm-hmm.
because he go to his Father.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the greater?
The greater is not that you can do a greater work, because there's nothing greater than what he has already done,
mm-hmm.
but you can do more of it.
Yep. That's the answer.
Mm.
And that's where.
Because there is no. That's my preaching voice. Because there is no greater miracle to perform than raising someone from the dead. What can you do that's greater than that?
Yeah.
Create them.
Yeah.
but he never created no. And Smith Gigglesworth.
Wigglesworth.
I always mix his word up. Didn't he raise people from the dead as well?
Yes.
So the greater would have to be because Jesus was one man,
mm-hmm.
and he by him being one, he was limited to time,
mm-hmm.
and he was limited to space.
Mm-hmm.
He could only be in one place at two times.
That's right.
Right. Or he could only be in one place at one time.
Mm-hmm.
Now that he's in all of us, he's all over the globe.
Yeah.
Now that's what I looked at as the greater word.
Yes, sir.
Exactly.
Jesus was not able to get to Rome.
Exactly.
He was not able to get to Cappadocia, Asia Minor, none of those areas. But because the disciples now, they're going further outward than Jesus could ever do.
Yes.
With him being a person, a human being, that is. Man in the flesh, God in the flesh, rather. So Jesus can only do Chicago.
Right.
But when he went back to the Father, and we know he made it back to the Father, because he said, if I don't make it back, the Comforter won't come.
He won't come.
So we got it, so we know he made it back.
He made it
back. Now, the greater work is they get to go further out.
That's right.
Spreading that message that he spread, preached about, and doing the works or the deeds that he done. Let me put it that way. Doing the deeds that he done. So that's why I looked at it as the greater.
Yes. Man,
that's
true.
Good.
And what took place in the book of Acts, the second chapter?
Yeah.
When Peter preached one sermon, what was it? 3,000.
3,000.
3,000 souls. And then he preached another one, and I think it was 5,000.
Some.
Just out of one message. And there was no way really for Jesus to go to 3,000 different people to save them.
Yes.
But now that he went to his Father, and now Paul said, it's no longer I, but the Christ that liveth within me, and he's in all of the believers, 3,000 souls can get saved. And can you imagine just the three of us go out and preach one sermon? If 3,000 souls, that's 3, 6, 9, carry the nine, multiply.
Carry the nine.
That's 3, 6, 9. That's 9,000 people that came to Christ because simply he went to his Father.
And I want y'all to know, y'all just got set up today. When we posted it, because many of the people out there says, man, I cannot wait to tune in to find out what is it I haven't been able to do that's much greater than Christ.
Right. Nothing.
You've been set up already.
Yeah, y'all been set up.
You've been set up.
Y'all been set up. Because when every time you turn on the TV and watch TBN, that's a greater work because it's called satellite. And they're reaching nations. Now, I can't tell y'all how many times I've disagreed with some of their programs.
Oh, yes, of course.
Okay. Totally. But.
Nonetheless. The message is getting out.
The message is getting out. It's a greater work. The Apollos, well, the Bible says he was a mighty man in Scripture.
Mighty man, mighty in Scripture.
Okay. But then the Apostle Paul introduced him to Aquila and Priscilla. And they showed him a more perfect way.
Greater.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
So it's still the Scriptures.
Yes.
I mean, you might be able, I can read, but you may have entered into Evelyn Wood speeding.
Yes, sir.
So you can get the message quicker than I can.
Right.
Because I might be stuttering. Mm-hmm. That's the whole reason why God gave Moses Aaron.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Because Moses lied.
Yeah.
But you have to understand something. Moses had been away from Pharaoh for 40 years.
Yes.
So he didn't remember their language.
Mm-hmm.
And most likely their language had changed.
Probably.
Because Paul said that Moses was a mighty spokesman.
He was.
So it had to be the fact that Moses would not understand this new lingo that's in Egypt, because I've been away from there for 40 years.
I don't agree with that.
Yeah. Well, that is
we'll argue over that next time.
Somebody lied. Didn't Paul say he was a mighty man?
Yeah.
Yeah, but and I wasn't in that
in words.
Regards.
Yeah, I don't think he was. I don't think he was a stutterer.
I don't either.
I used to think that because that's all we've heard in the pulpit. But
I just found out that Peter wasn't cussing. But go ahead.
Right. I don't think it was a stutterer, because the New Testament fixed that by saying he knew all of the ways of the Egyptians.
Yes.
Okay, and he just knew the mix of it all. All right, so he knew all of that. So and then talked about his speech, his words. So I don't think he was stutterer.
Well, now, can you not know all of that and still stutter?
That's true, but we can't find anything that says he stuttered.
Right.
I think it's the language of King James.
Pharaoh.
I think it's King James lingo that
would
makes
you go
him
and say what you got to say.
Spit it out. Come on, spit it out.
Spit it out. Absolutely.
Right. And this is, I agree. I think in the Old Testament it said, and he covered his feet.
Sure.
Which is another term for he was using the washroom.
He sat on the toilet.
He sat on the toilet.
Yes.
So the problem is, yes.
Wait a minute.
The king.
Not Moses. We're talking about Moses.
Not Moses. No. Moses never covered his
face. About someone else.
He was never human.
Yeah, before the brother got killed in it, he was in a latrine.
He was in a latrine. That's what they thought.
Yes. Yes. But he was in there a little too long.
Right. But the man, see, God, in his infinite wisdom, as we say.
His infinite wisdom.
Sent the left-handed man.
Uh-huh. Yes.
We need to deal with that left-handed
man. That southpaw. You can watch him.
Yeah, because, see, they used to a man drawing his spear from his left side with his right hand.
Yes.
But here, God sent the left-handed man.
Yeah.
And said, psst, God told me to tell you something.
You see what I'm saying? God always go against our knowledge,
our
logic, that is.
He has to ask, where is the wise?
Yeah.
Where is the scribe?
Where is he?
Where is the disputer of this world?
Then he also said that he uses the foolish things.
To confound
us. Confound y'all.
Yes.
Yeah. This article here may be a great summation of what the Ella Jones is saying here. They talk about in 1 John 14:12, Jesus makes an amazing claim. I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing.
Okay.
He will do a greater works than these because I am going to the Father. How? Jesus says it will be done through the power of the Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Okay. He speaks often of another counselor, the Spirit of Truth. Mm-hmm. Okay. And how exactly does the Holy Spirit operate? Jesus continues, and I will do whatever you ask me and what ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name. All right. It says that this is a fantastic one that ought to inspire and terrify. We Christians can enjoy the power of Christ's goodness on earth. Yet Jesus is not saying that our will be greater than he is in terms of power or majesty. After all, by definition, humans cannot surpass God's omnipotence, omnipresence, and his omniscience. Rather, most scholars agree that Jesus means we will do a greater works because there are many of us.
Correct.
Therefore, Jesus is acknowledging the collective power his followers can display in God's kingdom on earth. Jesus preached and healed and raised the dead in Judea only.
Mm-hmm.
Now millions of disciples exist worldwide. This is what Elder Gibson was saying. Mm-hmm. And through their belief in Christ and the agency of the Holy Spirit, many more miracles occur today than did in Jesus' times.
Mm-hmm.
After his resurrection, Jesus tells his apostles to make disciples of all nations.
All nations.
Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, and speaking to them, teaching them to obey his commandments, Matthew 28:19. He commissions them to go out because all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, Matthew 28:18. And he passes on that power and authority to his disciples through the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
The book of Acts provides early validation of the miraculous power Jesus promises. You have to go to Acts chapter 5 and on, and also Acts chapter 17 describes those who proclaim Christ as ones who have turned the world upside down.
Upside down is what they said about the disciples.
Yes, sir. This turning of the world upside down is surely part of what Jesus was referring to when he promised that we would do a greater work than he did.
Mm-hmm.
Many miracles were performed by his apostles and disciples, and many would be and are being performed as the gospel of Jesus Christ spread throughout the world. And the most wonderful miracle of all is that souls are being born again through the power of the Spirit. So that really fixes all of the naysayers out there, because when you look at the language of Jesus, he talked about some things that we think is going to happen later on, but he was talking to them at that time.
Right.
Even when he talked about something that this temple is going to be destroyed and built up, okay, in 3 days, okay,
right,
and once no stone going to be laying on top of each other, okay. And he talked about a couple other things where we're thinking, okay, it ain't happened yet. But he says, when this happens, you will see these people will see. When this happens, you will be able to witness it. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Then Jesus died, and a lot of my atheist friends say, you see, he died, and those people that he was with, they died. So that was false. Mm-hmm. But he was talking about the Mount of Transfiguration.
Right.
You're talking to Peter, James, and John when he says, okay, when I ascend, you're going to be there and you're going to witness it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so we have to be careful to be able to properly interpret the scriptures.
It has to be done in the context
yes,
that it's in first.
Right.
And then determine, because some of the stuff that we read in scripture may not be applicable for your audience.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, everything we read might not, right? You agree? It might not be, but you've got to know how to use it.
Yeah.
Okay. For instance, the 10 virgins, you know, better part about it, we always go with numbers.
Right.
Just leave the numbers alone. So let's just deal with the virgins. Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah.
We don't have to spend time on the 10.
Right.
The number 10 means, and mm-hmm. that's another thing that's ruining our church, is we spend too much time on numbers.
Numerology
and whatever, anyhow. Sure. But I believe that the key thing is we need to understand, and now there's another word that Jesus used here. He said, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me. Now, is he using a gender term? Is he saying either like a man or a woman, or is he using a generic term meaning anyone?
Right.
And I think that right there is what threw someone off. I think I was in a conversation a while back because, no, he says he that believeth, then greater works shall he do. Well, he's really saying anyone who believes in me, meaning all of the believers. Now, also I want to point out the word believeth. It means to have an active faith in him.
Mm-hmm.
Not just a faith, but an active faith. Yeah.
The present participle.
Exactly. Yes. The problem is our faith is not strong in him. Our faith is not active in him, and our faith is not living in Christ.
Right.
We spend a lot of time trying to do things on our own.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we call Christ our side. We beseech him. But we still don't trust him enough to lean upon him to fully take care of the whole matter.
True.
So a lot of times we don't believe that, yes, he has empowered us and told us because he's going to the Father. And if you notice, he goes directly into talking about the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Which means the Holy Ghost is going to come back and be and dwell in all of you. And it is he that's going to do the work. And all you have to do is be a vessel, a willing vessel, or open vessel. And you'd be surprised the things that we can do all because we yield our bodies, members to the Holy Ghost.
Yeah. Boy, I tell you, when I saw this topic, I didn't think we were able to do it for 2 hours because mm-hmm. the answer, we could have knocked it out in 5 minutes.
Oh, yeah, of course. But we preachers. We have to go around.
I love how you have to go around.
Yeah.
Because in going around, they learned a whole lot of other stuff.
True. That's what thing to be a preacher.
Yeah, yeah. Broner Scott says that Moses knew all of the ways of the Egyptians. However, he was not fluent in Hebrew. This is where Aaron comes into play.
Well, check it out. He'd been away from Hebrew for 80 years.
A long time.
And he was away from Pharaoh for 40 years.
Absolutely.
So it's like the man who got out of jail with the fish tank. He didn't know something had changed in his life.
The tanks in his shoes.
Exactly. Yeah. I believe that what was going on, I have to research it again, what was going on is Moses been in the wilderness mm-hmm. 40 years now. There's no telling what the language is in sure. Egypt.
Yeah.
So he will kind of be slow
yeah.
in what's going on now. I don't think he was a stutterer.
Yeah.
I don't think the language changed.
Yeah.
I don't think the out language changed.
Out of 40
changed.
Years?
And even if that is true, mm-hmm. Even if that is true, notice mm-hmm. what I'm saying. Even if.
If.
Yeah. That's true. Which I don't believe for the record. Don't believe that it is, but
say it one more time.
Yeah, even if it is true,
say it for the people.
Yeah. There are people that live in the United States or other nations, countries, and they move from their homeland,
mm-hmm.
and they went back to their homeland or their country or whatever, you know, and it can be 30 years, 40 years. Mm-hmm. I don't think you'll lose the language that you know natively or you was taught.
Mm-hmm.
People that's taught Spanish or people that's taught English just because they move from the United States where we speak predominantly English. Let's say, for instance, they go over to France. I don't think you'll stop. You won't know English no more mm-hmm. after 50 years of being in France.
Right.
Can I ask you a question? A personal
question?
You can
ask me. Yeah, go ahead.
Are you gay?
Man, you almost cussed twice.
but wait a minute. So to answer my question, are you gay?
No.
So you're not happy?
Wait a minute. So I see where you're going. The definition may change, but the language is still the same.
Really?
Right.
Yes, the language is still English. Mm-hmm. It just took on a different meaning.
Different meaning.
So it's still English.
But it changed in your own, right before your own eye.
No, actually, when I come along, it was...
it was changing then.
It was changing.
I'm saying that
y'all grew up in the Flintstone days. Where
yeah, but that would do.
Yeah, I did.
Flintstone days.
How's Bernie doing? I miss that old guy. But I'm not trying to persuade you.
Yes, you are.
My brother, to believe my way, though they may be right. My brother.
Any bean pies in here?
But allow me to unfold my common vernacular to you, my brother.
Go right ahead.
Okay. I just want to say that.
Yeah.
But no, that's just my, I'm going to reference them while y'all talk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but I don't think the language changed from Egypt. Whatever they speak over there back then, they still speaking it today. That's just my belief.
Sure.
Yeah. You know,
yeah.
Because when America was first, well, the Indians was here. He wasn't discovered.
Plymouth Rock landed on us.
Right. Yeah.
But they speak what we call now English.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think it changed since then, since Columbus came over here. I don't think.
Well, we got the King James Bible. It's 1611. 11.
Yeah.
And we still speak much of this English. Mm-hmm. We just don't do the this and the thus and the thous. But this is still English.
Right. Still English.
This is 1611. We went into slavery in 1619. Okay. It still wasn't the United States until 1776. Okay. 157 years later on. All right. Still the English, most of it is the same. It's still English. And I see what Gibson is saying is that the meaning changed. Because, you know, United States, we don't really have nothing original. Even our food ain't original. I mean, some of it is.
Well,
but we got French fries. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right. And our
American fries.
You know what our American fries is?
Hash browns.
Yeah. That's American fries.
That's so true.
Yeah.
And yeah. I will say this, though, as I close this session here. Here are some of the greater works that man has done. The wireless telegraph, the aeroplane, the x-ray machine, the automobile, I think is probably, to me, the greatest invention is the automobile.
Mm-hmm.
Light.
Yeah. Motion pictures, reinforced concrete, the phonograph, the incandescent electric lamp, the steam turbine. The calculating machine, I think that's a great invention.
Oh, yeah.
That's why it will cost you $1,000 for that little thing that y'all get for free from Walmart.
Mm-hmm.
That little thing, when it first came out, was $1,000.
Like PCR was $1 million.
It sure was.
Mm-hmm. $1 million.
Yeah,
PCR.
It was crazy. Yeah. Internet combustion engine. Let's see, submarine boats. How could something that heavy stay up on the water? Still a mystery.
Yeah.
The electric furnace. Okay, the diesel engine, color photography, photograph, the composing machine, the transmitting and transforming AC current, the electric welding, high-speed steel, Kodak portable camera.
Cell phones.
Oh, I missed them.
Yes.
110 cameras.
The liquid air. And these are all of the stuff that's from days on by. And then, of course, today we have a lot of this electronics that we have now. The cell phone being number one now, say, in history.
Mm.
How could you be able to talk to someone a million miles away where you are?
Right.
Instantaneously.
Instantaneously.
Who thought that would even be possible?
How can you fly in a plane?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, something that heavy stays in the air.
But what gets me is, where did man get all the material from?
Yeah.
I mean, he didn't dig a ground up and pull a plane up out the ground.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So all of the substance that he used came from the earth.
Yep, all of it. Yeah, it's natural resources.
And God put it there.
He put it there.
Wood,
for a reason.
And gave man the wisdom to be able to grab it and make it work.
Yep, there it is. And we discovered it in what they call the table, elementary table element, or whatever you call that table.
Table of
What is it called, y'all? Table element or something?
Element table. Table element.
Something like that. Yeah, and you get all of the natural resources, and I don't believe we found them all. Mm-hmm. These are just the ones that we've all discovered, and they believe, okay, well, that's it. There's no more. But nope, sorry. Because every time they go deep sea diving, they find another animal, a creature. They say, what is this? We thought Adam named them all. Here's some
he
more.
Probably did.
Yeah, he probably did.
I don't know.
Yeah. Natalie Bullock says a slow speaking tongue. Does that mean Moses was just awkward or that he stuttered?
He stuttered. Yeah. I'm saying he stuttered.
I don't. Yeah, I'm in it right here. I don't know.
I don't think he stuttered.
He said it real fast.
I don't think that. Brony Scott says Elisha performed twice as many miracles as Elijah.
Mm-hmm. He asked for that.
He did ask for
it. He said he wanted a double portion.
He did. Yeah.
And when was the last one performed?
When he thought he was done. Uh-huh. He threw that body in there on that.
And when that body fell on him, that's when the double. Because I think one did 16 and he did 32.
Yeah, he doubled it.
So when he died, he was 31. Yeah. When that body
hit that man,
hit him, that was come 32. Mm-hmm. So he got his double portion.
So to let you know, it's something in his bones. I'm going to preach that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Lord, something in his bones.
Them bones. Them,
them bones,
bones.
Them bones.
Drive.
This is a good word, y'all. I really enjoyed this immensely. The elders are here doing their thing. You know, I would like to do what I'm going to call the PK effect.
Sure.
Next week?
Yes, the PK effect. Mm. I've been getting people asking me, why are the pastors or elders' kids the way they are?
Because they play with the deacon kids.
Yeah.
Because them deacon kids some rough kids.
Yeah. So let's work that in next week. It could be a 2-for-1 sale if y'all want to next week. All right. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, but that's one I want to talk about. The PK effect. PK. Let's see what that's all about. Hey, CC, play my news music in the background. Let's go ahead and read this news. And I'm ready. And I'll go off with this here. This is Thursday's Investigative Reports from Mayor Lakita for the Sir Walter Jones Show. Religious news. Most American churchgoers are hearing politics from the pulpits of their churches during this president season. According to a new survey, nearly two-thirds of the respondents, that's 64%, in the survey released Monday, August 8th, by the Pew Research Center, says their clergy have spoken about at least one political or social issue in the spring and early summer. And 14% said their pastors even have spoken about a specific presidential candidate. That's even though churches can be stripped of tax-exempt status for endorsing or opposing a candidate under the Johnson Amendment, which both Donald Trump and the Republican Party platform have said they want to repeal. But more than three of all recent churchgoers say the political talk happens only sometimes, rarely, or never. Hot topics include religious liberty and homosexuality, with a percent of recent churchgoers saying they'd heard about either one of those two topics. And that was followed by abortion, 29%, and immigration, 27%, and less frequently environmental issues, 22%, and economic inequality, that's 18%. In Olympic news, congratulations to U.S. gymnast Simone Biles on clinching the gold medal in the women's individual all-around gymnastics competition. Right behind her was Allie Raisman, also of the United States, winning the silver. Alia Mustafina took the bronze medal. Mm-hmm, I said that. This day in religious history, Roman Emperor Theodosius declares Christian religion a state religion. I'd like to apologize for Barack Obama and Michelle. Didn't get a chance to interview today. We ran out of time. You guys are probably down there still fighting the Second Amendment. But
he's whooping his daughter.
He's down there doing what with his daughter?
He's whooping his daughter. But twerking
and
smoking weed.
Oh, Lord, he's smoking weed. Thank you, Facebook Live, for chiming in on this thing. Y'all go to Spreaker.com. Spreaker.com. And hear the show again and share with everybody who think that the greater work that they're going to do is do something greater than what Jesus didn't do. Mm-mm, sorry to tell you, boo-boo, that's not the case. Tomorrow on the show at my place, Friday, Five Star Friday, we're going to talk about sex. We're going to talk about sex education. Mm-hmm. We're going raw, y'all. We're going to try to save y'all's marriage by going raw, raw, raw. We're going to talk about sex education among Christians. We're going to talk about some stuff that your pastors and preachers just won't talk about. I'm gonna go raw. I'm gonna go over and across the edge. Mm-hmm. So if you are young and you're trying to get married, man, this is that show's gonna be for you. And if you're married and you just can't look at your wife now because, well, yeah, some stretch marks is causing your libido to go, then you want to tune in tomorrow's show because we're going to talk about it. We're getting ready to get what y'all might think is dirty, but I'm about to educate y'all to save your marriage. Mm-hmm. That's tomorrow. It'll be at my place, so I can't do it here because the FCC might shut me off, so I can do it at my house. All right, so tune in tomorrow. Plot. We're going there. Spreaker.com, y'all. I appreciate it. CC, thank you for spinning the wax. Love you guys. This is it. This is the Walter Jones Show.
You have been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show, where Sir Walter Jones provides you with a biblical perspective on everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones at his website, www.sirwalterjones.com. Search the Sir Walter Jones Show on Facebook or follow on Twitter at Sir Walter's Music. Until time, thank you for listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.
Ladies and gents, if you missed any of today's show, head to Spreaker.com and search the Sir Walter Jones Show and listen to the show and past shows. Now remember, search for the Sir Walter Jones Show on Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker spelled Spreaker.com. And enjoy.
I'll be your light.
log on to urbanbroadcastmedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered.
Hi, Mr. Walters.